Welcome to Hydrogeology 101 Key Concepts. Today I'd like to talk about porosity. Porosity is the measure of the amount of void space in a rock or sediment. It's really important for hydrogeologists because this void space, or empty space, can be filled with water. So we need to know how much space is available, particularly if we want to do managed aquifer recharge. There are two types of porosity. Primary porosity is formed at the same time as the sediment or rock. The pores in sand and gravel are primary porosity. If the voids are formed after the rock has been formed, it is called secondary porosity. The fractures in the granite and the dissolution caverns in the limestone are secondary porosity. If we had 1 cubic meter of dry sand, we would need about 0.3 cubic meters of water to fully saturate all the pore spaces or void spaces between the sand grains. Porosity is the ratio of the void space to the total volume. It's normally expressed as little n, and we calculate it by dividing the volume of voids, so that's the total volume of water that we've added to our sand, by the total volume. In this case, it would be 0.3 cubic meters divided by 1 cubic meter, which makes 0.3, or 30%. Note that it's okay to express your porosity as a decimal or as a percentage, but it's advisable to use the decimal for our calculations. Here are some examples of porosity values from Krusman and Derrida. Notice that the highest porosities are found in unconsolidated materials like gravel, sand, silts, but mostly the porosity is under 50%, with the exception of clay, where it can be a little bit higher. However, the porosity in clay is a bit of a special case because the water in clay is bound to the clay minerals and most of it cannot be drained. To understand porosity better, I'm going to take you down to the river where I live here in Spain. The limestone rocks from these mountains has been eroded and transported down the river to form all of these alluvial gravels, which you can see here. You'll notice that the pebbles are arranged in a special way with respect to each other. One of my sisters even did her PhD on this subject, so hello Carmen if you're listening. The way in which the pebbles are arranged with respect to each other is very important in controlling the porosity of the material. To illustrate the effect of packing, let's assume that we have a sediment of perfect spheres, like a bunch of marbles. If we arrange them in this fashion, we would have a porosity of 47.6%. If we pack them a little tighter, then our porosity would decrease to 26%. How does grain size affect porosity? Let's say we have a large-grained sediment, like a gravel here, with big pore space between the different grains, which is full of water, shown in blue. And then we have a sand, which has smaller particles, so also smaller pore spaces. And finally, we have a silt, which has even smaller grains and even smaller pore spaces. You might think that the porosity in the gravel should be higher than in the sand or the silt, but actually that would not be the case if the particles were completely perfect spheres, because the ratio of the void space to the particles remains the same at any scale. In practice, however, the sediments with the smaller median grain size tend to have a higher porosity. So actually, the gravels have a lower porosity than sands or silts. What happens if we have a mixture of grain sizes? For example, what is the porosity of a sandy gravel? To understand this, we have to look at the effect of sorting on sediments. Here we have a gravel made up of perfect spheres with water filling the pore spaces, shown in blue. All the spheres are the same size, which means that the gravel is well sorted. The porosity is quite high, probably close to 50%. Now, if we take this gravel and we fill up all the pore spaces with sand, you'll see that the porosity has been dramatically reduced. So all this blue space here that was full of water before now is occupied by sand and water. When we have a mixture of different sized particles like this, it means that the sediment is poorly sorted. As a rule of thumb, the highest porosity is found in well-sorted sediments. The poorer the sorting, the lower the porosity. So let's get back to our question. What is the porosity of a sandy gravel? Let's assume we have a gravel with a porosity of 0.4 or 40%. Now we fill up all the pore spaces in the gravel with sand. As the porosity of the gravel is 0.4, we would need 0.4 cubic meters of sand for every cubic meter of gravel. The new porosity of the sandy gravel is no longer 0.4. It must be less, as the pore space between the gravel is now full of sand. It is the porosity between the sand grains which now controls the overall porosity. The sand has a porosity of 0.5 or 50%. However, there are only 0.4 cubic meters of sand for every cubic meter of gravel. The porosity of the sandy gravel will therefore be 0.4, which is the amount of sand in the gravel per cubic meter, times by 0.5, which is the porosity of the sand, which makes 0.2 or 20%. Notice that our gravel, which has started off with a quite high porosity of 40%, has been reduced to a porosity of 20% by adding the sand to the pore spaces. The real world is, of course, much more complicated than the example we just looked at. In most sedimentary sequences, we can expect a range of different layers made of different materials. Here's an example of a gravel, sand, and sandy gravel sequence with a total thickness of 15 meters. For every square meter of aquifer area at the surface, we can calculate the quantity of void space that will be below it. So, for example, in the gravel layer, the volume of voids will be 0.4, which is the porosity of the gravel, times by 2 cubic meters, which is 0.8 cubic meters. For the sand, we take the porosity of 0.5 times it by 3 cubic meters, and we have 1.5 cubic meters. And for our sandy gravel, it is 10 meters thick, so it's 0.25 times by 10, which is 2.5 cubic meters. Notice that the total void space is 2.3 cubic meters for the well-sorted gravel and sand, which make up the top 5 meters, and only 2.5 cubic meters for the 10 meters of sandy gravel below. To calculate the average porosity of the whole sequence, we have to add up all the different volumes of voids, which is 0.8 plus 1.5 plus 2.5, divided by the thickness of the sequence, which is 15 meters. So the total is 4.8 divided by 15, which makes 0.32 or 32%. What happens to the porosity if the sediment becomes cemented? Here's an example of a pillar made of cemented gravel. You can go and have a look at it in Alhambra of Granada, Spain. The rock used to be a sandy gravel made up of well-rounded classes of different rocks. Then the matrix became completely cemented and it turned into quite a hard, competent rock. That means that the pore spaces were filled up with calcite minerals, so the porosity will be much less than the original sediment. It's probably less than 5%. Okay, let's have a look at how we can apply what we learned today to estimating groundwater resources and groundwater recharge. Here's an aquifer which is made of cemented gravels. That means that it has quite a low porosity, and we've assumed it to be 0.03 or 3%. The aquifer is 50 meters in thickness, and last August the static water level was about 12 meters below the ground surface. That means that we have 38 meters of saturated aquifer. We can calculate the total volume of voids by multiplying the porosity 0.03 by the thickness 38 meters, and we end up with 1.14 cubic meters. Now that is the amount of groundwater in storage before the recharge event. So we had 1.14 cubic meters of water in storage here for each square meter of aquifer surface. Between August and December, the groundwater levels rose by 6 meters, which indicates that recharge was taking place. The amount of recharge can be calculated as the porosity 0.03 times by 6, 0.18 cubic meters. So this is the amount of groundwater recharge, which works out at about 180 millimeters of recharge. When we're dealing with recharge, we generally report it in millimeters. During January of this year, a managed aquifer recharge scheme ran an experiment, and they managed to raise the static water level by another 2 meters. The amount of recharge due to managed aquifer recharge is 0.03 times by 2, which is 0.06 cubic meters, which works out at 60 millimeters of recharge. So we can estimate that the total groundwater recharge was 240 millimeters, and about 25% of this was due to groundwater recharge from the managed aquifer recharge scheme. The total groundwater in storage after the recharge event is about 1.38 cubic meters per square meter of aquifer. Well, I hope you enjoyed this small session on porosity. Thank you very much for your attention.